As I mentioned earlier, I was assigned two chapters, Revelation 6 and Revelation chapter 7. We generally took a sweep through chapter 6 in the first session. I'm going to read chapter 7 to prepare us and introduce it for this session, but we're going to go back to Revelation chapter 6. I'll briefly review, and then I want to add some things to it to help us understand the content a little bit better. And then we'll move forward into chapter 7, and my hope is we'll have some time to deal with a few other things that kind of help you understand this book as a whole. So I'll start by reading Revelation chapter 7, we'll pray, and then we'll get into our second lesson here this morning. Revelation chapter 7, verse 1, "And after these things, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree. And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God, and he cried with a loud voice to the four angels, to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea, saying, Hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. And I heard the number of them which were sealed, and there were sealed 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel. Of the tribe of Judah were sealed 12,000, of the tribe of Reuben were sealed 12,000, of the tribe of Gad were sealed 12,000, of the tribe of Asher were sealed 12,000, of the tribe of Nephilim were sealed 12,000, of the tribe of Manasseh were sealed 12,000, of the tribe of Simeon were sealed 12,000, of the tribe of Levi were sealed 12,000, of the tribe of Issachar were sealed 12,000, of the tribe of Zebulun were sealed 12,000, of the tribe of Joseph were sealed 12,000, of the tribe of Benjamin were sealed 12,000. After this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands, and cried with a loud voice, saying, Salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb. And all the angels stood round about the throne, and about the elders and the four beasts, and fell before the throne on their faces, and worshipped God, saying, Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto our God forever and ever. Amen. And one of the elders answered, saying unto me, What are these which are arrayed in white robes, and whence came they? And I said unto him, Sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, These are they which came out of great tribulation, and I have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore are they before the throne of God, and serve him day and night in his temple. And he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, and shall lead them unto the living fountains of waters, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. Let's pray. Father, again, we thank you for this time to get into your word, to look at these things. Look at the revelation of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, in connection with your prophetic plan and purpose for the earth, for the nation of Israel, as well as for all the world. Father, as we know, as those who rightly divide the word of truth and the dispensation of grace in which we live, we will never experience one of these things being fulfilled as far as the tribulation and the anguish and the wrath and the judgments. And although we won't experience your kingdom here on this earth as Israel will, as they're your chosen people for the earth, we will experience your kingdom in the heavenly places as members of the body of Christ in connection with our vocation and our calling. And Father, as stated earlier, may we look at this book in light of what Paul teaches, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, you'll gather together all things in heaven and on earth in Christ. And therefore, the end of the revelation commences the beginning of the dispensation of the fullness of times. So may we see the importance of it for a new dispensation that we'll participate in called the fullness of times and the gathering together of all things under your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. So again, we give you all thanks and praise for this time and your word that we're able to study and learn more of wherever it may be, from Genesis to the Revelation and everything in between. We give you all the thanks and praise in Christ's name. Amen. We eventually are going to get into chapter 7 here. Revelation chapter 7, as we just read, talks about the sealing of the saints of God, essentially, in their forehead. There's some interesting, it's an interesting context in the first couple verses, and we'll take some time to look at that, but you really kind of got to have some other things understood to kind of get an appreciation of that. But fundamentally, you have the sealing of the 144,000. That's a remnant of the children of Israel. But the people that are going to be saved from their ministry is what's being described there in verse 9. You have a specific number that's mentioned, 144,000 and 12,000 out of the 12 tribes of Israel. But when you get to verse 9, you have a great multitude which no man could number. And those are essentially the from all nations, kindreds, people, tongues, and they're before the throne. And you move from the beginning of chapter 7 to in the tribulation period, or the 70th week of Daniel, and you move all the way to the end of the kingdom, or not the end of the kingdom, the beginning of the kingdom. And where there's no, as it says there, in verse 15 and verse 16, there's no more hunger, there's no thirst anymore, there's no sun light on them, nor any heat. They're going to be serving God. He's dwelling among them at the end of verse 15. He's going to wipe away all their tears at the end of verse 17. He's going to feed them. He's going to give them drink and all these kind of things. And so you move from at some point in the 70th week of Daniel, what we often recognize as the or call the tribulation period, even though that's not specifically accurate, it gets the point across, to the beginning of the kingdom. And we'll look at that more as we go forward. What we dealt with in the first session, again, was Revelation chapter 6. We saw in chapter 5 that John is taken up hither into the heavenly places before the throne of God. It's not just a vision that he saw, it's an actual reality that he sees. He sees the throne of God, he sees all of its beauty, all of its peculiarness, especially in connection with things on the earth. He sees the four beasts around in their four faces, and he sees the 24 elders, he sees how they worship God, he sees essentially how holy and how pure it is, and all those kind of things. And then you get into the one who's at the right hand of the Father's throne, the right hand at the throne of God. That's the line of the tribe of Judah, the lamb that was slain. And we are introduced to this book that we find out on the back side of it has seven seals, that no man in heaven, nor on earth, or under the earth could open it. And John wept. He wept much. And one of the, one of the elders comes along and says, "Don't weep. Because there is one who has prevailed." That's the root of David. That's the line of the tribe of Judah. He has prevailed. And in connection with fulfilling the first mandate of the Davidic covenant, being functioning as the Redeemer and providing redemption, all power is given unto him. We saw that in Matthew 24, I believe it was verse 18. I could have that reference wrong. But all power in heaven and earth is given unto him. And part of the power is that he's able to open this book and execute all of its judgments, execute all of its wrath and its justice for the sake of fulfilling the Father's will in reconciling the earth and making it what he wants, what he's planned and he's purposed it to be. And as he begins to open it, he begins to open up these seals. And we began to look at what these seals are. Seal number one is in verses 1 and 2. And that one is the issue of a white horse, and the rider is on their that's on the horse, which again, we came to understand that there's these seven spirits of God. Not seven holy spirits, that would be blasphemy. Not seven ways in which God manifests himself, or the fruit of the Spirit. A lot of ways in which can be interpreted, a lot of people and how they look at it. But these seven spirits of God, God has many, many spirits. They're called angels. They're identified as such in Hebrews chapter 1. And as his spirits, they're his ministers. They go out and minister things on his behalf. Well, these seven are specific and they're distinct. They are unique of all the angels, as other ones are unique. Michael and Gabriel are unique. But these seven are unique. That's why they have a capital S. If you ever read the King James Bible, they are given a capital S, spirits of God. You can see them in chapter 5 there in verse 6. And God utilizes these seven, and he sends them forth into all the earth. And we're going to take a look at them a little bit more in this session. But they're the riders of these horses. And as all power is given to Christ, he gives them power or a crown to do something. And as he opens the first seal there, or when he opens the first seal, John comes and sees the implication, the ramifications of the opening of that seal. And the first one is a white horse, and the one who sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given to him, verse 2, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. And then in the second seal, when it was opened, John comes and sees, verse 3 and verse 4, then went out on another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another, and there was given unto him a great sword. And we kind of summarize the first two seals in connection with battle and warfare. When you take peace from the earth, you have conflict and possible chaos going on. That's what would summarize the impact of the opening of these two seals upon the earth. And then we moved into the third one, and when that one's opened, John comes and sees, and verse 5, and beheld, and lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts say, a measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny, and see thou hurt not the oil and the wine. And we talked about that one can result in famine. A measure of wheat was basically a meal, one meal. A penny was about a day's worth of wages. And so in order to eat one meal, you'd have to work a day and have a day's work to have one meal. And so when that takes place, there can be famine. There's many ways in the scriptures that famine comes about. You go back there in Joseph's day, and you have a lack of rain producing, obviously, a lack of crop and their agriculture, you're going to have famine. But there's also another way of famine under the courses of punishment in Leviticus 26 is that Israel would sow their seed in vain. They would plant their crops and those kind of things, but then their enemies would come and take of it, making a famine for the people of Israel. Well, here you have another famine in regards to the what seems to be some type of economic or change in regards to how much food you can get for the money that you make. And as it's described here, that's what it's going to be like out there yet future. And so we talked about wars, kind of summarizing the first two seals, and we talked about famine being the issue of the third seal, and then we got to the fourth, verse 7. And when he had opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth beast say, come and see, and looked, behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was Death and Hell, followed with him. These are angels that are given a name, Death and Hell, and we already read in we read in the first session previous to this that the one who has the power and the keys of death and hell is the one who's prevailed, the Lord Jesus Christ. The battle on the cross was real at his weakest point, and the adversary is Satan's strongest point. He thought he won, but he came out victorious, and he was resurrected, and he now has the keys of death and hell. And as you go through the book of the Revelation, you realize that the Lord still utilizes death and hell. He has power over it, but he utilizes it to his end and to his purpose, especially in connection with condemnation and judgment to those who do not change their minds about him and about his Father and do not believe what they're supposed to believe out here. But they're given power, as it says in the middle there, verse 8, unto them, and power was given to them over the fourth part of the earth to kill with sword and with hunger and with death and with the beasts of the earth. And then we notice verse 9, the fifth one. And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell in the earth? And white robes were given unto every one of them. And it was said unto them that they should rest yet for a little season until their fellow servants also and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled. Not much takes place in the fifth seal, at least with the opening of it at the first. All that is recognized, John doesn't have to go and see as the other ones. He doesn't have to come and see what takes place on the earth. He's there before the throne. There's these souls under the altar, and he sees them, and he hears what they're crying. How long before God avenges them and avenges their blood upon them that dwell on the earth? And so there's this issue that comes out of the fifth that is really significant, and we'll touch more on that as we go on. And then in verse 12, the sixth one. And I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood, and the stars of as blood, and the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as the fig tree casteth her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. And you go back and read the prophets, and you read Job, when God looses the bands of Orion and binds the sweet influences of Pleiades, and the earth is going to reel to and fro like a drunkard, and there's going to be a great earthquake like there's never been on the earth till that time. And it's going to be an absolute phenomenal event, to the point where the rich men and the prominent men, the kings of the earth, verse 15, are in fear of so much, yet not enough, because they don't change their mind about the one whom they know is on the throne and who is bringing upon this wrath, as they acknowledge there in verse 16. But they go hide themselves in the mountains, and they beg the rocks to fall on them and to kill them. But there's one who has the power of death and hell, and he's not done with them yet, because what he's going to do is he's going to bring the great day of his wrath upon them. And all those seals, how dramatic and how drastic they are, the seventh one, the great day of his wrath, and it being there, by the time we get to the end, through the effects of the sixth seal, that's when the Lord himself, up until this time, it's him sending his spirits out and sending them forth through the earth to bring about these judgments, bring about and influence the earth, and bring about his wrath. But the great day of his wrath is the issue of when he comes. And he'll come from heaven glory with darkness in heaven, darkness on this earth, because the sun is turned to black, and the only light that will be his and his glory as he comes through the heavenly places to this earth. And they will fear, but not enough to the point where they change their mind about them. In fact, they want to battle him, and he's going to vanquish them. Anyways, what I want to do now in having that reviewed is I want to give some timing to these things. I want to, one, look at these horsemen a little bit more and how they're spoken about prophetically in the Old Testament, and see what they were doing in the Old Testament and the similar things that they're doing here. And then I want to talk about how to put some timing to all this. And then we'll move on into chapter 7 as we talk about the timing. So with that being said, come back with me to First Daniel chapter 9. Daniel chapter 9. As I mentioned before, the book of the Revelation is the last book that we have in our Bible. Not the last book written, but the last book that we have written in our Bible. It's the, when you're looking at things prophetically in regards to Israel's program, it is the last book. There are many, many, many things that you need to understand in order to really understand the book of the Revelation. You can go through the book of the Revelation and you can grab things out of it and understand some things just by studying it, but that's not the way it's only to be understood. It's supposed to be understood in connection with things that came before it. And two major places, they're not the only places, but two major places to understand more about the book of the Revelation is Daniel and Zechariah, as well as with some things that the Lord, when he's here on this earth, say. We're not going to have time to go through all of what we could, but we're going to go through a little bit. In Daniel, you have many visions, and many visions that involve time and what's going to take place from Daniel's day forward. And he's given great detail in regards to the times of the Gentiles, the times of the Gentiles in regards to the Gentiles that are going to rule over Israel and serve themselves of Israel, the Assyrian and Babylonian captivity. They're in this first section for 70 years, the Medo-Persian Empire, Greece, what's going to come out of Greece is Rome, and then you're going to have the Antichrist and his kingdom being set up. And you're given that vision in Daniel 2, and as you proceed on in Daniel 7 and Daniel 8, you get more and more information comes and it focuses upon this time. In Daniel chapter 9, you get this timeline that comes along and puts a, a time frame upon these times of the Gentiles. In fact, that expression that the Lord gives in Luke chapter 21, I believe it is, the times of the Gentiles, is a combination of the visions in Daniel. The visions of the Gentile nations that are going to serve themselves, and the times that they're going to have to serve them, to rule over Israel. And you're given that timeline here in Daniel 9. Look at verse 24. Daniel is actually praying to God for this information. He now knows that Babylon isn't going to be the only nation that rules over Israel, that there's going to be other nations that come after Babylon. And now he wants to know the timing. He also knows that there's going to be certain nations, and then eventually God's going to set up his kingdom. He's going to destroy all the other kingdoms before it, and then he's going to set up his kingdom. Daniel wants to know how long until that takes place. And God sends Gabriel to give him that information, and you have it here in verse 24. He says, 70 weeks are determined upon who?
Thy
people, and upon what? That is so important. It doesn't mean that there's only going to be 70 weeks. By the way, you have a week is how many days?
7 days.
1 year for each day. So you have 1 week is 7 years. So you have 70 weeks times 7 is 490 years. There's 70 years that come before this, equaling 560. And you have 560 from the Babylonian captivity until that kingdom set up. But that's not the only time. That's the time that's determined not upon the whole world. It didn't say upon the world and upon the Gentiles. It says that's the time determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city. In other words, this timeline is specific to the people of Israel and upon the city. Okay, because there's other time outside of that 70 weeks, and we'll talk about that as we go forward. But he goes on, he says, to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to seal upon the vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Then he says this in verse 25, he's going to give a breakdown of the 70 weeks, the 490 years. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem. Now that's going to be right after this first section, the Babylonian captivity. King Cyrus, the king of, Persia. The Medes came kind of first, and then it was Persia. King Cyrus is going to give a commandment to allow Israel, who was taken out of their land during this 70 years, so the land could enjoy her Sabbaths. It gives them a commandment that they can go back into the land and go back and build Jerusalem. Build the temple again that was destroyed by Nebuchadnezzar and his army. King Cyrus, a Gentile king, comes along and he's going to say, go and build it. When that commandment goes forth, that, because it's determined upon thy people and upon thy what? Thy city. So when he gives that commandment to go and build Jerusalem again, that's when the time, the 490 years, the 70 weeks begins. And then he says, unto the Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks. Notice that comma there. It's an important comma. And 62 weeks. And what you have is 70 weeks. You have 49 years. That's going to be this time. In that 7 weeks, that 49 years, that's what's going to take them to rebuild Jerusalem. In actually building the temple again, according to, I believe it's John chapter 1, it takes them 46 of that 49 years. Now, they end it at the 49th year, but the reason why it takes them that long is because they build it in troublous times. In other words, they go to build it, and trouble comes against them. It halts their building. Then finally, they go and build some more, halts their building, and those kind of things. And it ends up taking 49 years. The actual building of it takes 46 years, okay? And so that's that 7 weeks. And then he says 62 weeks. That 62 weeks is essentially that 434-year time period. Or I might be getting my math mixed up here, but What is it? 62 times 7. Who can do that math? 3 score in 2 weeks.
434.
Thank you. 434. I was right. 434. 434 year unto Messiah the Prince. Now, when you start to look at these things, you have, when the Lord starts his earthly ministry, Luke chapter 2, I believe it is, talks about that he starts when he's about the age of 30. Therefore, he's born about 30 years prior to that, roughly. There's a gap of time of silence of 400 years, and then you have 430 years when he starts his ministry, and we know roughly, again, roughly, that his earthly ministry was about 3.5 years. John the Baptist came about 6 months prior to that, about 434 years. Now, unto Messiah the Prince, that's when he comes into Jerusalem, and he's riding on the ass of a colt and a donkey, and they say, Hosanna, Hosanna, the Son of David in the highest, all these kind of things, and he gets presented as the prince, as the king of the people. Now, you know through that period of time that they reject him, and eventually he's crucified. But 434 years, when he comes into Jerusalem, there have passed. And what you have, he goes on, he says, go back up there to verse 25. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks and 3 score and 2 weeks. So this section, the building, and then 434 years after that, 49 years, to when he comes into Jerusalem. He's going to come to the city, and he's going to come to the people, and he's going to come as the prince, okay? Shall be 7 weeks and 3 score and 2 weeks. The street shall be built again, and the wall, even in troublous times. That's what's going to be right here. It's going to be built. And then it's going to come, and he's going to come as Messiah the Prince. And then look at verse 26. And after 3 score and 2 weeks shall Messiah be cut off. And that's what you have. He's presented after that 3 score and 2 weeks as Messiah the Prince. They reject him as their king. And I believe it's in, what chapter it is. I want to say Matthew chapter 22. But he says, O Jerusalem, O Jerusalem, how much I would have gathered you like a hen gathers her chicks, but you would have me not. And therefore I make I'm leaving you desolate. That's a horrible paraphrase, but a paraphrase nonetheless. And he leaves them desolate, and he leaves the temple, he leaves the city. And right then he goes up to the Mount of Olives. Right after that, he goes up to the Mount of Olives, where he's going to return, and he begins to talk about the end and what's going to take place after that. He's cut off in a sense. And obviously, a few days later, they're going to crucify him. And he's cut off, as it were. And then after that, he's cut off, verse 26, but not for himself. He's not going to be cut off for himself. He's going to be cut off for the people. He says, and the people of the prince. Now, that's a lowercase p. That's the Antichrist. But the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war desolations are determined. And he, that's the prince, the Antichrist, shall confirm the covenant with many for how long? 1 week, 1 year for each day of the week is how many years? 7 years. So that's where we get the last week. That's where we get Daniel's 70th week. 70 weeks are determined. He goes down through how many weeks there are. And the last week, the last 7 years, is what we identify as the tribulation period. And it starts with the prince confirming the covenant for 1 week. And it says, and in the midst of the week, so 3.5 years in, he shall cause the sacrifice and oblation to cease, and for the overspreading of abominations he shall make it desolate, even unto the consummation, and that determined shall be poured upon the desolate. Now, there's a lot of details we can't get into, but you have a general framework of time. For 90 years, 434 years, 1 year time is going to be added in Luke 13. We're going to talk about why I think this is 10 years, because it doesn't start right away. But that last 70th week is going to be seven years, okay? Now, with that time frame in mind and having that with us, come over to Zechariah chapter 1. Zechariah is prophesying when the commandment goes forth to restore and to rebuild Jerusalem. That's when he's fitting in. So on this timeline, we can't really see it, but you have a whole bunch of prophets prophesying before this fifth course of punishment into the first installment of it. You have all the prophets there, but Isaiah through Zephaniah prophesy during that time. Daniel gets to prophesy kind of in between this first and second installments here, between the Babylonian Empire and the Medo-Persian Empire. Daniel's there for both. Zechariah, Haggai, and Malachi, the last three was often known as the minor prophets in the Old Testament, are prophesying during the second installment. They're there when the building's going on and those kind of things. Zechariah is prophesying during that time. And Zechariah is given eight visions, what's going on. And when you read these eight visions, they are, and you know Revelation, and you've read Revelation, they're so close. Now let me give you a little bit more context. They are going to rebuild Jerusalem in what kind of times? Troublous times. Troublous times. And what God's going to do during this time of rebuilding and restoring, there's going to be trouble. And out of the trouble, he's going to establish and rebuild his city and his temple. And all of it is designed, it's really happening, don't get me wrong, it's really happening. But it's also a type as well as a prophetic in regards to this troublous times. And him not necessarily restoring or rebuilding, but the issue of his the establishment of his kingdom. That his kingdom is going to come out of that trouble. Okay, so there's a parallel between what's going on back here to what's going to be going on here. And you're going to encounter with Zechariah horsemen. You're going to encounter angels. You're going to encounter seven of them. You're going to encounter angels measuring the city and the temple that's being built here. Well, you also, out there in Revelation, get an angel measuring the temple and the Jerusalem and the kingdom out there in the day of the Lord. You have chariots and, like I said, horsemen. You have a woman with an ephah. And you have a woman out here, that great whore, Babylon. And there's so many connections. And so once you have Daniel down, Zechariah is kind of the next major place to get some understanding about Revelation. I just want you to see that a little bit. And it gives us some understanding about the horsemen that we encountered and the riders in Revelation 6. And then what we'll do is we'll put some timing to it. So I'm going to have to do some work here. But look at verse 7, Zechariah chapter 1. And upon the four and 20th day of the seventh month, which is the month Sabbat, in the second year of Darius, came the word of the Lord unto Zechariah, the son of Berechai, the son of Iddo, the prophet, saying, I saw by night. Notice that, I saw by night. It's dark. Behold, a man riding upon a red horse. He stood among the myrtle trees that were in the bottom, and behind him were their red horses, speckled and white. Then said I, O my Lord, what are these? And the angel that talked with me said unto me, I will show thee what these be. So he begins to see these horses and someone riding the horse. And he asks the angel that was talking with him, what are these? Show me what these are. Verse 10. And the man that stood among the myrtle trees answered and said, these are they whom the Lord hath sent to walk to and fro through the earth. Now, you might not recall, but when we came out of Revelation chapter 5, we saw those seven spirits of God, those seven angels, and they were what? Sent forth into all the earth. The four horsemen and the riders of those horses are four of the seven angels. And I'll show you why they're distinguished four of the seven, okay? But look what he goes on to say. They are sent to walk to and fro through the earth. Verse 11. And they answered the angel of the Lord that stood among the myrtle trees and said, "We have walked to and fro through the earth, and behold, all the earth is still and is at rest." Now this is taking place back here, okay? I'm trying to show you the parallel to out here. So they're sent out into all the earth back there. And what do they find? Remember, they're identified in Revelation as the eyes of the Lord. The Lord utilizes them as eyes to see what's going on in the earth. God doesn't have to do that. He chooses to do that because he's awesome. And what they see, by the way, when they go walk to and fro through the earth, that's showing some authority and possession and those kind of things. But the earth, is it chaotic? No. It's what? It's still and it's at rest. We were back there in Daniel chapter 7 during this time of Zechariah, who's going to start rebuilding things and be a part of all that and those kind of things. But how are they going to rebuild it? In a time of rest and stillness? No, troublous times. What do you think this horsemen and these angels are going to do? They're going to cause unrest. God begins that. And it's a type of what he's going to do out here. It's his day out here. And I mentioned in the first session, all that long suffering is done. It's his day. He's that cup of his wrath and indignation, it's filled now. And it's overflowing and he's pouring it out. There's mercy and grace in the day of the Lord for those that want it. But overall, the general stance that God has through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, is I'm done. And I'm pouring out my wrath. Justice, it's time. And no more. To the point where he leads that. He starts that. It's not man starting it. Man fell a long time ago. God's long suffering. He's been holding back his justice and his day and his wrath. Now it's time that he starts it. And he starts it by this horse and their horsemen. They go out and they see this. It's still in at rest. Look at verse 12. Then the angel of the Lord answered and said, "O Lord of hosts, how long wilt thou not have mercy on Jerusalem and on the cities of Judah, against which thou hast had indignation these 70 years? He brings up this time. You haven't had mercy on Jerusalem and Judah for 70 years. How long before you stop, until you start having mercy on them? And the Lord answered to the angel that talked with me with good words and comfortable words. So the angel that communed with me said unto me, Cry thou, saying, Thus saith the Lord of hosts, I am jealous for Jerusalem and for Zion with a great jealousy. And I am very sore displeased with the heathen that are at ease. For I was but a little displeased, and they helped forward the affliction." There's two things going on. I don't know if you caught it. He is jealous for Jerusalem and for Zion. And he wants to have mercy on them. And the mercy in the context historically is to rebuild Jerusalem and the city. But he's also displeased at the heathen that are at ease. And that's setting up the environment for his jealousy to rebuild Jerusalem and his displeasure of not having the Gentiles be at ease, producing them to rebuild Jerusalem in troublous times. He's displeased at the ease that the heathen are in, and he's going to forward the affliction. He's going to start the trouble. Not because he's against Jerusalem. He's jealous for them, but he's also the God of the heathens. Even back here. And so he goes on, verse 16, "Therefore thus saith the Lord, I am returned to Jerusalem with mercies. My house shall be built in it, saith the Lord of hosts, and a line shall be stretched forth upon Jerusalem. Cry yet." So he is going to do it. He's going to return. That commandment's going to go forth. God's going to go back to Jerusalem. He's going to, the city is, and the temple is going to be rebuilt. But he says, "Cry yet, saying, Thus saith the Lord of hosts, My cities through prosperity shall yet be spread abroad, and the Lord shall yet comfort Zion and shall yet choose Jerusalem." In other words, this isn't going to be it. this kingdom, when they get that temple set up and they get that their city built back again, that's not it. He's going to yet choose Jerusalem, that kingdom. And that's an important fact, because when you get to the Lord's earthly ministries, man, they love that building. They love that temple. They love the walls of that thing, and they're so proud of what they built. Even his disciples, when they brought him out after he was cut off there, and he leaves it to them desolate, and the very first thing he says, there will not lie one stone upon another. This isn't my temple. This isn't my city. I'm bringing mine down. And what he's describing here is, although things are going to take place yet, you have to look at something that's yet to come. Okay? But notice what's going on. These angels and these horsemen are going to forward their affliction. They're going to produce the trouble because God's displeased at the ease that the heathen are in. The same situation is going to take place. After the rapture, the world and those kind of things, it's going to get to the point where it's at ease. And God's going to be displeased with that. And so he's going to send those four seals there, those four horsemen, and what they do is one is given a crown to go forth conquering and to conquer. The second seal is opened up, and one is and given a great sword to take what? Peace from the earth. There's peace going to be out there, and he's going to take it from them so that they kill one another. And then he's going to come along, and he's going to have that pair of the third seal, the third horseman, he's going to have a pair of balances in his hand. And there's going to be influence in regards to famine and all those kind of things. And then you have the issue of the death and hell that are able to hurt the fourth part of the earth. Those four horsemen we see back here, and we'll see the four here in a second. Let's go on. Verse 18. Then I lifted up mine eyes, he sees another vision, and saw and behold four horns. And I said unto the angel that talked with me, what be these? And he answered me, these are the horns which have scattered Judah, Israel, and Jerusalem. Four Gentile nations. Boom, 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 boom. And they serve themselves of Israel, and they're scattered. What's interesting is, at that point, they're in the land. But they've been scattered, they continue to be scattered, and they're also, guess what? When you're done with Paul and you read Hebrews, James, 1st, 2nd Peter, where are the 12 tribes?
Scattered
abroad. They're going to be scattered abroad. And the Gentiles are going to be at ease. And there's going to be peace. And God's going to forward that affliction. He's going to start opening up this book. And he's going to start to have his day. But notice what else he sees. Verse 20. And the Lord showed me four carpenters. Then said I, what come these to do? And he spake, saying, these are the horns which have scattered Judah, referring to verse 19, so that no man did lift up his head. But these, the carpenters, are come to fray them, to cast out the horns of the Gentiles, which lifted up their horns, singular, going to be the man of sin, over the land or the king at that time, but it's going to culminate to be the son of perdition, the man of sin, out there in the end time, who lifted up their horn. There's four horns, four Gentile nations, but they're going to kingdoms over Israel, and they're going to lift up their horn, one king. It's going to be the Antichrist, over the land of Judah to scatter it. And what the four carpenters are going to come to do, a carpenter utilizes the elements of the earth, as it were, to build things. Or, if need be, destroy things. They use wood, everything we see all around us. You think, well, that plastic and all that kind of stuff, even that, it's all the elements of the world manufactured and harnessed by man one way or another. And these four carpenters, they're four of the seven angels, but what they do is they deal with or they handle the elements of the world to bring God's wrath upon it. And they start to do that with the four seals, and then they continue to do that. That's why you have, they burn up the grass, and they dry up seas, and they change water into blood, and they do a whole bunch of things in connection with hurting the earth to avenge the blood of those of the blood of the saints of the Most High. There's three other ones, but you look at those three other ones and they don't necessarily hurt the earth. They do a lot of other things, but they don't necessarily utilize the earth in regards to God's judgment. You might have one who looses the locusts out of the bottomless pit or something like that, but the four are distinct out of the seven distinct angels of the innumerable company of angels, as Hebrew says, to be carpenters in the sense of utilizing the elements of the earth to bring God's wrath upon it. Does that make sense? And you're going to see that through the book of the Revelation. And they do that to fray them. They're at peace and at ease, and he utilizes the four to fray them, to make them afraid, to make them fearful and terrified. Come with me to the end of chapter 3, Zechariah chapter 3. Chapter 3 brought Joshua the high priest. He's given a white robe, like the robes out there in Revelation. But look at verse 8 of chapter 3. He says, "Hear now, Joshua the high priest, thou and thy fellows that sit before thee, for there men wondered at God's people." Joshua the high priest is a symbol out here in the day of the Lord of the kingdom of priests that God's people are going to be and how he's going to utilize them. "And their men wondered at, for behold, I will bring forth my servant, the branch." They're going to be men wondered at because of his servant, the branch. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. It's capitalized. That's why it's capitalized. The branch, the root of Jesse. He grows up as from the root into the branch. He's the thing. Verse 9, "And behold, the stone that I have laid before Joshua, upon one stone," that's the Lord. He's the rock of offense. He's the living stone. He's the cornerstone, the chief cornerstone. The one stone shall be what?
Seven eyes.
There's those seven angels again. "I will engrave the engraving thereof, saith the Lord of hosts, and I will remove the iniquity of the land in one day." That's going to be the great and terrible day of the Lord. "In that day, saith the Lord of hosts, shall they call every man his neighbor under the vine and under the fig tree." You're going to see that seven again in chapter 4. Pick it up in verse 2. He says, "And said unto me, What seest thou? And I said, I have looked, and behold, a candlestick all of gold, and a bowl upon the top of it, and his seven lamps thereon." Seven pipes to the seven lamps, which are upon the top thereof. And in fact, out here at this time, they see those seven. Look at verse 10. "For who hath despised this day of small things?" The rebuilding and the consummation of the building again in Jerusalem, the Lord calls a day of small things. Because when he's going to bring his kingdom back down, it's going to be a great, big thing. But he says, don't despise that day of small things. And he's going to bring up when Zerubbabel, he was in charge of the building, He says, "For they shall rejoice and shall see the plummet in the hand of Zerubbabel with those who?" They got to see those angels out here. They're going to see them out here again too. They're still going to reject them. When that angel comes and he shares that everlasting gospel, I don't know if you ever read that in Revelation, that's to the whole world. That message is sent out by an angel that every man, woman, and child on earth can see and can hear. He sends it out to the whole world. And it's their last chance. And if they're going to reject that everlasting gospel, you know what the next message is? Prepare ye war. Because I'm coming. And it's going to be done. But they get to see them out there. You get to chapter 6 and you start seeing these chariots and those kind of things. The horses come up again. They're sent again into all the earth. And they forward the havoc. Now, come with me over to Matthew 24. And I got to wrap this up here. Matthew 24. His Because they depart from the temple, and the disciples want to show him the buildings of the temple. And the Lord says, "See not all these things." Verse 2, "Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down." Verse 3, he brings them upon the Mount of Olives, sits down, and they ask him, in light of what he just said, when are these things going to take place? And he starts giving them detail about the end times. Verse 4, "And Jesus answered and said unto them, Take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many." Now look at what he describes, and think about this in light of the four horsemen and those seals. First one was conquering and the conquer. The second one was taking peace from the earth. The third one we summarize as a famine. Look what he says, verse 6. "And ye shall hear of wars." And by the way, those four horsemen that go in, they don't necessarily go to Israel. It doesn't say that. Those seven spirits are sent forth into all the earth. So it's not necessarily upon the city and upon his people. It's on all the earth. In the land, many are going to come and say, I am Christ. But outside the land, verse 6, "And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled." Because that's what it's going to be. It's going to be troublous times. But they're not to be troubled. "For all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And there shall be famines, and pestilences, and earthquakes in diverse places. All these are the beginning of sorrows." Just the beginning. And when you go and read through Revelation and those seals, especially the first four, it's just the beginning. And what Revelation does is it starts to cycle, starts to take you back to some of those things that he's mentioned. And it'll bring you a little forward, and it'll bring you back, and then it'll fill in more details, and it'll bring you back. Sometimes it'll bring you all the way back to the beginning. Sometimes it'll bring you to the midpoint. Sometimes it'll bring you right up and close to the end, right before the kingdom's established. Now, I just got to give this to you because we can't get into it right now, but I'm going to try to write this out for you. The first seal is not a part of the 7 years. Here is the 7 years, or the 70th week of Daniel. Okay? The first, second, third seal are the beginning of sorrows. Oftentimes, those are put into the 7 years. But when you're following along the doctrine and the timeline, and you have all of that before you, and you understand the death and hell issue, and you understand Isaiah, we didn't go back to the passage, but when they make an agreement with death and hell. Remember that fourth horse, death riding it, hell follows with them, and they hurt a fourth part of their... It doesn't say they hurt Israel, but they hurt a fourth part of the earth. Israel signs a covenant with the Antichrist, the man of sin. To them, it's a covenant of peace. Anyone who tries to hurt them, he goes after. That's how he woos them. He comes in peaceably with flatteries. And he destroys some of Israel's enemies and brings the spoils to them. And they think, this is our Messiah. There's peace. He sends out the four horsemen. There's no longer peace, wars and rumors of wars. And in that situation, Israel's in the middle of it all. And here comes this one that rises up and he makes a covenant that says, don't hurt Israel. You don't hurt them or I'll hurt you. That's what those first three seals are. And the fourth one is the issue of death and hell is roughly starts that 7 years, that covenant of peace that we saw. Now, you also have the fifth one. The fifth one is the saints under the altar, right? They're crying, how long, O Lord, until you avenge me? And he says, wait but a little what? Season. You learned in back in Daniel that right at the midpoint, there's a little season. It's about a month's period. Not 30 days. When the abomination desolation takes place and the Antichrist gives everyone the opportunity to bow down to him, and if not, he'll chase after you and he'll try to kill you. And from that time forward, there's great tribulation. There's great tribulation. And the adversary is against not only Israel as a people, but the believing remnant he's after. Because not all Israel is of Israel. And he goes after them. And many of them during this 30 days, they can't get out. They die. They're killed by him. But then the Lord up there on his throne, he opens up those prayers of the saints. And it fills the temple so that no one could be in there besides him. And he's going to avenge the blood of his people. That's why it's great tribulation. On the earth, it's great tribulation because the man of sin only has 3.5 years. No more room is found in heaven for him. And he umps the ante, as it were, as far as his tribulation. But from heaven's perspective, it's because God's bringing his wrath. And there's great tribulation. Now, I'm just going to give these things to you. One of the reasons, so the fifth one, I don't know why it's not writing. Oh, here we go. The fifth seal is right here at that midpoint. The sixth seal is right here at the end. You see, the sixth seal is the great earthquake. And you go through Revelation and you'll find that great earthquake always almost right before the seventh seal, the great and terrible day of the Lord. That's when he comes. It's dark. There's a great earthquake. And it said no one will know the day nor the hour when he comes. Part of that is there's actually a time period in here of when he'll come. In other words, you could guess every one of those days and say he's going to come at that time. But part of that expression is the sun's out. The sun is dark. The moon is turned to blood. They're not necessarily going to know the day, nor the hour. And so when he comes, it's all dark. So much of that changes. So much of time and things like that, and the scripture says there will be time no more, and those kind of things. All that's relating to one another. And then there comes a time, as he comes as a thief in the night. And they're told at that time, that's when you are to watch. It's after the sixth seal, and they're waiting for the seventh. They're waiting for when he returns, and they're told to watch. And in that darkness, you have all those parables and those kind of things that when he's come, you better be ready when he comes. And then he comes, and that seventh, and he vanquishes his enemies. And all that route that Moses took up from Egypt, and Joshua took in the land, and he circled down through up to the valley of Jehoshaphat, the Lord takes the exact same route. And he's not touching the earth. He's riding upon his horse. His armor is before him. His word before him is his reward after him. And he comes through. And he just like when he brought Moses through every one of those places he goes to war with, and those 10 confederate nations that are surrounding Israel and those kind of things that have gotten into bed with the Antichrist, he starts to destroy them all. And you have prophecies like Isaiah 63, it is, and he says, who is this that cometh from Bozrah, from the south there? His garments are stained are red, stained in blood. Because he's come from the south, and he's tread in his winepress alone. He only is able to do this. And then he comes up through and he enters over Jordan and he's drying up every water because that's where the hotbeds of the adversary are. They live below those waters and in the seas and in the rivers and those kind of things in the heart of the earth. And he's drying up all that. He's destroying the spiritual realm. He's destroying the physical realm. And he dries up the Jordan River. He enters in, loops around, goes to the Valley of Jehoshaphat where the armies are coming against him. They're destroying themselves because it's dark. And then he stands upon the Mount of Olives. It cleaves and he just destroys them to the point where the blood is up to the bridle of the horses. And he calls, before he does that, he calls the fowls of the air to feast upon the carcasses of the kings of the earth. And he tells his believers that, who are off scattered, he says, that's when you'll know when I'm going to be here. Because you'll see all the eagles and all the fowls over there feasting upon the flesh of the kings. That's when you'll know I'm here. There's a lot more we can say about that and the book of the Revelation, but when you look at those seals, at least that's how I've come to understand them. I could be absolutely wrong. They're not issues to divide over, specifically isn't to us, but it is for us. And when you, if you want to know, I believe those trumpets, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 trumpets here. Then he opens the vials, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 vials there. And the 6th seal and the 6th vial and the 7th seal and the 7th vial all line up together. It cycles back. And if you're just paying attention to those vials and those seals and the trumpets, and you start seeing the events, they all cycle back. Or roughly there around. Some of it is a little bit before than others and those kind of things. You're given some time periods in there. By the way, I'll give you one other thing and then I'll end. One of the other major pieces to the book of the Revelation is understanding the beast. The beast and the whore, the great whore that is riding the beast. The whore is Babylon, the beast is Assyria. It is not revived Rome. The Antichrist is an Assyrian, the prophets say. He comes from Assyria. He does like his fathers have never done before. He comes in peaceably. All of his fathers before him came in at war with Israel. And it was a dead giveaway that this guy, that these people were against Israel. This guy doesn't come in at war. He comes in peaceably. But what's in his heart is to destroy them. And his own people reject him because of that. But by the time we get to the end of Revelation, his power base is in Babylon. And just as you have a an Assyrian-Babylonian connection here, so too is there Assyrian and Babylonian connection here. What started the times of the Gentiles, Assyrian-Babylon, that's what is going to end with Assyria and Babylon. And that beast that mother of harlots rides has 7 heads, which are 7 mountains, which are 7 kings. And when they read Revelation, when at the start, there's one that is yet to come, who will continue a short space, and the 8th that comes. There's only 7 of them, but there's 8. The 8th one is a resurrected one of the 7. You can find out, I'm persuaded. Maybe no one else is, and that's fine. But I'm persuaded you can know exactly who the man of sin is. He's a resurrected Assyrian king. He is there. He is the 8th. He is one of the 7, it says. And there's something that you can identify him with. He has a deadly wound by a sword. He was killed by a sword, and he's resurrected, and the world is in awe and wonder that he's alive when he comes. And you go back and you look at Assyria, there was 5 kings. There's one that is out here. There's one that's yet to come. He continues for a short space. And then the man of sin comes, but he's of the 7. And I think I understand he's one of the 5. When you go back in 2 Kings chapter 15 through 20, you're confronted with 5 kings of Assyria that come against Israel. And one of them is given more space, more length, than any of the other ones. And if his name's not a dead giveaway, Sennacherib, a sinning cherub. And he tries to go attack Jerusalem, but King Hezekiah prays in the God that that wouldn't take place. And God says, I'm going to turn back the sundial 6 degrees, I think it is. And all that's indication that he's going to come back again. And Sennacherib goes back, guess where? To Nineveh, where Assyria and Babylon is. And his two sons kill him. And guess what they kill him with? A sword. That guy is going to come back. I'm persuaded. Maybe not. That's fine. It's no big deal. It's not that big of an issue as far as for us. And you know what, another thing that characterized Sennacherib? He spoke great blasphemies against God and against God's people. The very thing that the man of sin is going to do. And he's going to get his time. He came to the gates of Jerusalem before. Wasn't successful. He had to turn back. And he's going to come back. He's going to come against Jerusalem. And he's going to have his day. And God's going to give him his day. And he's going to destroy him for all eternity. And that guy comes back. And they wonder at him. And they're in awe and amusement. He's got signs and wonders. His false prophet comes up and does great signs, miracles, and wonders. And then he goes back to Babylon. And God destroys both it and him. In fact, when he comes, the man of sin, the one that the Satan has used, is going to be right there. And the Ancient of Days is going to come down with his kingdom. He's going to be sitting on the throne. And his son, the Son of Man, comes to the Ancient of Days. And they're going to see this. And there's one right next to him, the man of sin, the one whom the Satan has utilized as his pawn, as the man of sin. And Lucifer wanted to be like what? The Most High God. He was the anointed cherub that covereth. And he fell from that position. And instead of that man of sin getting to be like the Most High, the Father comes along and says, Son, here's the kingdom. And he burns up the man of sin in front of everyone. There's some fabulous things in prophecy, prophetically. And one of the great things you can do is try to put those things and lay them out. There's a lot that we're not going to understand. There's testimony of that in Revelation itself. There's seven thunders that are sealed up that won't be revealed until that day. But there is so much that we can understand. And I think it gives us an appreciation of our God and of our Savior, of His justice. Paul utilizes the vengeance that is going to be poured out there in the day of wrath as, in one sense, a comfort for those who are enemies against us. We're not supposed to avenge evil for evil, recompense evil for evil. Well, that's not our job. But Paul does come along and talk about that God will have his day of vengeance. Rest in that doctrine that he'll do that. And one of the things that you can see in his vengeance is this going to happen. Now, you don't wish that upon anyone. But it also is a comfort that justice will be served. And it will be served in his day of wrath. Well, I hope that helped you somewhat in understanding. I know we didn't get to chapter 7. Chapter 7, he loops back. That fifth seal, the avenging of the blood of the saints, starts the midpoint of the tribulation, essentially. But before that takes place, he sends out those four angels again. They have power over the four winds of the earth to hurt the earth. They're the carpenters. And another angel comes along and says, hold off. We have to seal the saints of the living God first. Once they seal them, then he begins to avenge the blood of the saints that have died. And you have the fifth seal going on. There's other things we can get into. Obviously, we just don't have the time. But hopefully that has helped you understand a little bit of the book of Revelation and pricked your curiosity. I know this study has pricked my curiosity to know a little bit more. And it's one of those studies to have on the back shelf. We're supposed to know all of God's Word, even things that get a bad rap in Christianity, right? Revelation is one of the books that has mutilated the most. It's completely confused and can cause a lot of frustration for people. And hopefully, I didn't add to that, but lessen that somewhat. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time to get into your word, to look at the book of the Revelation, look at these seals, look at the events, look at some order in connection with these things, timeline back in Daniel. Look at what you were doing back there with Zechariah and the restoring and building Jerusalem, and how that was a foreshadowing of the prophetic events that will take place yet here after us. I think we can get some detail and some insight into all that. But most of all, Father, may we know what our Apostle Paul teaches in regards to those things, that we're not appointed unto that day of wrath. You have chosen us from the beginning of the world in connection with the mystery of Christ, in connection with us being members of your body. You have chosen us to salvation, not salvation from the debt and penalty of sins, but all those that do possess that salvation. You have chosen us to be saved from the day of wrath, to be saved by your Son's life, the Lord Jesus Christ. And to, although witness those things, no doubt, not be ones who have to experience those things here on earth. For we will not be on earth. We'll be in the heavenly places, most likely at the judgment seat of Christ, being instilled into our positions in the heavenly places for all eternity. We thank you for our blessed hope that you have given us. We thank you for the salvation in Christ, not only from the debt and penalty of our sins, but the salvation that our hope provides, not only in the sufferings we experience, but physically, as we experience our bodily resurrection at the rapture. And Father, we thank you for the promise that you give to the Apostle Paul in connection with that day. Our day in the heavenly places is at hand. It can take place at any moment. And so we say with Paul, Maranatha, come Lord Jesus. And while we wait, may we patiently wait, getting all the godly edification in Paul's epistles that we can get, and come to learn all things that were written aforetime, which are written for our learning, as well as the things that come hereafter the dispensation of the grace of God. So we give you all the thanks and praise. And lastly, we pray if someone's here listening and has not trusted Christ, how they died for their sins, was buried, and rose again, that they would believe that good news this very moment and be saved for all eternity. And we thank you as well for this time of grace giving. We don't do it grudgingly or out of necessity, but willfully and cheerfully, according as you love a cheerful giver. It's all in Christ's name we pray. Amen.